Welcome to the Source Material Comics Podcast at episode 270, 270, closing in on 300. That'll be probably before the end of the year. We are here to discuss a new comic book, six-issue series, titled Harley and Ivy Meet Betty and Veronica. And joining me, as always, the man, the myth, the legend, Mark Radulich. Mark, are you ready to talk some DC and some Archie comics tonight?
Am I ever? I'm so excited that I just can't hide it. I am about to lose control. I think I like it.
All right. I don't know if I like it. Squeaking in under the buzzer, our favorite representative of the Honeysuckle Rose creations. It is Alexis Hanna. Welcome back to the Source Material Comics Podcast. Are you ready to talk some DC comics and some Archie comics?
Yes, I am. Under the Wire is right. No, it's no fun to go to the comic shop to pick up your order and find out that the part-timer put in an order for Vampirella and Red Sonja Meet Betty and Veronica, not the other one.
Yeah, that would have been an interesting discussion if that book actually had been there. You read that and then came on the show.
I think we should. Quite frankly, I'm good with having done both.
Oh, well, I'm sure you would have.
Well, you would have, but Red Sonja and Vampirella hasn't come out yet. So I walked in, he's like, well, of course your book's not here. It hasn't been released yet. And I'm just staring at him going, excuse me.
First of all, you're a dumbass. Second of all, now give me the comic I ordered.
Exactly. Exactly. Well, all right. So, Mark Radulich, tell me why this was on the schedule. I'm curious as to why we've ventured down this road.
Because it calls to us, Jesse.
Ah.
It begs us. Harley and Ivy Meet Betty and Veronica demands to be read and reviewed by the Source Material Podcast.
And the masses.
And the masses. And the masses.
I mean, you know me. I'll read anything written by Paul Dini.
That's right.
So a couple of things, if I could be serious for just a moment. One, this has got quite the staff on it. Mark Andraco, who I like a lot. Paul Dini, who is responsible for Harley Quinn in the animated series. A lot of his stuff ends up being really, really good. This week on TV Party Tonight, we're reviewing the Harley Quinn animated series on DC Universe. So I really did want to talk about this when I saw it. I love fun comics. I mean, stuff that's just outwardly silly ends up becoming a lot of fun to talk about. And so I wanted to give this a whirl, and it did not disappoint, in my opinion.
Okay. We mentioned Paul Dini. We actually talked about Zatanna on here back, what was it? I think it was me, you, and Alexis.
Yes, mm-hmm. Sir.
When we did the Zatanna series. Zatanna? How did we say that?
Zatanna.
There we go. So yeah, we've talked about Paul Dini quite a bit on here. Mark Andraco, though, I can't say that I know too much about the guy. I've heard his name before. Hopped on the wiki here. I'm looking at his bibliography. Manhunter 1 through 38 from 2004 to 2009. This was a DC comic. He was apparently teamed up with Jesus Saiz and Jimmy Palmiotti. Wonder Woman 77. I don't know if anybody. Okay, yeah, I was going to say that's a pretty popular title. Batman Streets of Gotham 1 through 13, 2009 to 2010. These two come together to write Harley and Ivy Meet Betty and Veronica. Oh my goodness, the Archie Comics crossovers. So if you have listened to Source Material in the past, we've covered Archie Comics at kind of like, you know, just because they were crossing over with another property. We discussed Punisher versus Archie on this podcast a long, long time ago. I know we've done some other stuff with Archie Comics. Oh, Predator versus Archie.
Yeah, buddy.
Predator versus Archie, which was an interesting comic.
The world's greatest tongue-in-cheek book.
Oh, no kidding. There's a lot of Archie titles out there that recently have kind of started to gain a lot of popularity, one of which I've mentioned here a few years back, which was Afterlife with Archie, kind of like your Walking Dead zombie take on Riverdale. Mark Radulich, do you have any experience with Archie comics?
I mean, just what we've read on here. I haven't read anything on my own. I remember once upon a time, my wife walked around the comic book store and I was like, hey, what are you interested in? Maybe I can help you find something. And she was like, do they sell Archie comics?
Oh, man.
And I walked away from her. I actually left her in the store and pushed her away.
Yeah, I would say, at what point do you just look up in the sky and say, I have failed as a husband?
Well, that's a daily thing. but I just, you know, this is... No. I never read. I don't watch Riverdale. I wasn't interested. This isn't my speed. Like, I like a lot of funny stuff, but a lot of funny comics. But I've never really gone the Archie route.
The thing that I recall Archie being synonymous with me is just, you know, silly, goofy, fun time comics stuff. I was never really ever interested in reading. They had a whole line. I mean, Archie's been around, I think, shoot, since the 40s, I want to say. Pep Comics, this property, these characters have been around for ages. They obviously have to have something going for them if they've been around that long. Alexis, you read any Archie comics before?
Not really. I remember reading them a little bit when I was younger, mostly because they were the comics that popped up in other magazines. It was frequent. Your parents got a Reader's Digest, and there was a couple Archie comics in there.
Yeah.
I would always sneak a peek at those. I did watch the first three seasons of Riverdale, mostly to stare at Cole Sprouse. He is gorgeous with the black dyed hair on that show. He really is. But I'm not going to lie. Reading this book, it was so bizarre. When you watch Riverdale and you read and watch The Chilling Adventures of Sabrina, and you realize that this is a giant retcon to both series, essentially, because you just have to reprogram your brain.
Mm-hmm.
Like, okay, no, it's not the same thing. It's not the same thing.
Yeah, there are some elements of the series that I can kind of pick out through here. I mean, I gotta let everybody know, if you are somebody that likes Archie comics and know what Archie comics look like, this does not look like your typical Archie comic. The artist, Laura Braga, I believe is her name, she brings more of a modern comic book tone.
Heavy or
modern
cleavage, I believe, is what you're looking for.
I wasn't going there. I was just saying, both of you don't have much of an Archie background, neither do I. So, but we know who Harley Quinn and we know who Poison Ivy are. I know that we've talked about those characters ad nauseum on here before, so we won't go into that again. But let's talk about the story that happens in Harley and Ivy Meet Betty and Veronica. When Poison Ivy sees that billionaire Hiram Lodge announces plans to drain Sweetwater Swamp in order to build a free college with a convenient shopping center surrounding the campus, she and Harley Quinn head to Riverdale to make sure this attack on nature does not happen. As the Lodges prepare for a costume gala with the theme of heroes and villains, the regular characters of Riverdale, Veronica Lodge, Betty Cooper, Archie Andrews, Jughead Jones, and others plan to attend. This is where Harley and Ivy plan to kidnap Veronica to change her father's mind, but are stunned to see that, by sheer chance, Betty and Veronica have dressed up as Harley and Ivy to go with the theme of the party. As the story progresses, you add into the mix some magic from Zatanna and Sabrina Spellman that causes the two pair to switch bodies, a concussed Reggie Mantle that believes he is the Joker, and a dirty loan shark investor in Lenny the Lamprey, who helped with the majority of the financing of Hiram's project, you have the recipe for some zany, wacky action that only Harley Quinn, Poison Ivy, Betty, and Veronica can bring you. There you go. 10-cent synopsis at hand. So I said I was going to break this down issue by the two issues as we go. Now, I only have just sparse notes of what happens between issue one and issue two, okay? Because there really isn't a whole lot. Although, I'll tell you that there was a lot of text in these six issues. But the main beats are this. So issue one, we prepare for the costume gala that they're getting ready to do. We have Betty and Veronica making their decisions on the costumes, which I thought was pretty fun. And then there's a mention in that first issue of Pure Heart the Powerful, which, did you guys know that Archie was a superhero at one point? Although yes. I cannot fathom a way of trying to explain the fact that Archie is reading a comic about himself being a superhero in this book. But that's pretty just the Archie universe.
Well, I mean, he holds it up and it's the old style of Archie drawn on the comics. So,
yeah. So I don't know if it's actually about Archie or not. I have no idea. But either way, you have to take those things and you have to set them aside. Then we have Josie and the Pussycats showing up in issue two, who Catwoman is apparently a fan of. She's apparently seen them perform 35 times. this was my other moment of issue two. Harley sees Reggie and she yells "Puddin'," but it's not for him. The fact that he's dressed up like the Joker. No, it's the fact that there's a bunch of pudding behind him and she is just ready to eat it right up.
Yeah, this is liberated Harley. She's not obsessed with the Joker anymore.
That's right. That's right. And then in this second issue, we have the body switch where there's some crazy magic that happens. Zatanna and Sabrina mix their magic. And lo and behold, the two pair end up getting switched into each other's body. So Harley is in Betty's body and vice versa. And then Veronica is in Poison Ivy's and vice versa. And they end up passing out. Selena grabs both Harley and Ivy, throws them in the back of the Catmobile or whatever she drives. I don't know. Maybe it was just a car. But she throws them in the back and takes them back to Gotham. So here we have Betty and Veronica, and they're heading back to Gotham. Hijinks await. So, Mark Radulich, do you have anything you'd like to say about the first two issues?
I love the whole series, but to me, this was like the perfect setup. One, even though Harley's like the first name in there and probably like the big selling point to this, this isn't solely resting on Harley. The impetus to get them all together and move the plot forward falls on Poison Ivy, who, she sees the thing that she's interested in dealing with. She doesn't want the wetlands to be corrupted and constructed over whatever. And she's like, well, we got to go there and stop it. Mm-hmm. That gets them going to Riverdale. Plus, there's this other like B plot of, well, they've pissed off everybody in Gotham. Which tracks with those two.
Yep.
So, like I said, they're playing into all of the things we know about Harley and Ivy, which I thought was great. And that gets them to Riverdale. And, of course, Harley and Ivy have a great charisma together. You know, they're always fun. And you'd have to be a pretty terrible writer to mess that up. Yeah. On the other side, you've got Betty and Veronica, and they have a natural antagonism. You know, they're frenemies.
That's
as
right.
Near as I can tell. So they're fun together. And you see, like, if you read the Archie comics, what little I do know of them, what they're doing in there is pretty typical. You know, you have, I think it's Veronica, who's like the rich snob, and Betty, and they're kind of sniping at one another. And there's a lot of fun teenage stuff happening with them. And then they collide. like, I don't know if you've ever been a girl, Jesse, but from what I've been told, okay, when a girl shows up to a party and another girl shows up to a party and they're wearing matching outfits, it's Wolverine and Sabretooth.
Oh.
The claws come out. So it's a fun thing to see them play on that with the costumes, and of course the costumes of our titular villainesses.
Yeah.
So all of that was fun. This was perfect plot structure to get everybody in place, perfect characterizations. It was just delicious.
We can't forget about this guy by the name of Peachhead.
Oh, that was so funny. I almost wrote you about that because it was just like, when did this turn into a Dick Tracy comic?
Okay, see, I was thinking the same thing, but personally, I thought that was too silly even for Dick Tracy, so I was going more Duck Twicey.
Neon Noodle!
I have never seen. Okay, so I'm trying to find out if that was his name. Was that his name? Was Peachhead?
They were calling him that after a spell went awry, it was like one of Poison Ivy's toxins went awry and turned his head into a giant peach.
Yeah, so, it says here, I was working as hired muscle for Poison Ivy when she tried out her new fruit flesh serum on me. Now I'm stuck with a peach for a puss.
He serves probably for two of the funniest gags in this book.
Yeah, he does.
Oh my gosh, does he ever. Alexis, tell me about these first two issues. What were your thoughts?
Not going to lie, when Harley and Ivy first appear dressed in their classic DC costumes, which is pretty funny. It is, and I'm not going to lie, it is actually great to see Harley back in that full-blown Harlequin outfit.
Yes.
I mentioned this before on other shows. I get a little tired of how they try to constantly change up her outfit. It's like she's a Harlequin. Just stick to the... I know it's a little weird, but just stick to it. Mm-hmm. Yeah, Betty and Veronica show up in the newer costumes, but then you have Harley and Ivy switch back into their newer costumes, so they are exact duplicates of Betty and Veronica now. And I'm not going to lie, some of the artwork, it got a little confusing trying to figure out, wait, which character was which.
Yeah, I had to focus on what they were saying in order for me to understand who was doing what. Like, it would become, you would, if you followed the dialogue, you're like, okay, I get it. And to a degree, the hairstyle on Betty and Harley helped as well. But you really had to look at it with a fine eye and pay close attention.
Yeah, I did love the little line when Archie's trying to find somebody at the party who also read Pure Heart. He talks to another character who I can't tell who that was, but he's dressed as Brainiac. And he says, sorry, my comics reading began and ended with that chicken inventor and his bulb-headed assistant. Nice little throwback to Gyro Gear Loose and Little Bulb. And I love that Sabrina looks over and goes, was he in the Groovy Ghoulies?
There's a lot of that in this book. A lot of like breaking the fourth wall kind of one-liners, which I really appreciated.
Yeah.
I also want to add, please tell me I'm not the only one that actually wants to see a full issue of Zatanna and Sabrina.
Oh, yeah. There is no doubt in my mind. Like, I was like, that's got to be like the next thing that happens between these two companies.
Yes.
There's no way that you
But who would they meet? Can you do like Red Sonja and Vampirella meets Zatanna and Sabrina?
No, you take, okay. Well, right now you have two copies. You have two companies that are crossing over with DC. No, you have them go up against, they have to go on an adventure against villains from both companies. Now, I don't know what Sabrina's villains are. What's that? Satan?
Yeah.
Oh, who's the woman that's the like Satan's right hand gal that's Lilith. On the show?
Yeah.
Lilith?
Yeah.
Just under the name, though, doesn't she? Like Madam Fear or something like that.
By the way, first appearance of Archie was in Pep Comics number 22, December of 1941.
Madam Satan.
That's the one.
Madam Satan.
Yeah.
I'm Madam.
Madam Satan be doing something in the DC universe, and she goes after like Zatanna or something like that. I think you should have it with the whole fucking Justice League Dark. Like, just have a whole issue. Oh, just have a whole series where it's Sabrina in Justice League Dark.
Completely humor driven. That would be great, actually, because and you know how dark and serious I'm sure Justice League Dark is. There's got to be some humor injected in there. Just
fucking Constantine having to stop himself from hitting on a teenage girl.
What'd you think of the body switch plot here, Alexis?
I hate to admit it, but it does take a minute to swallow because it's just like, well, apparently when you cross spells between witchcraft and sorcery, that is what happens.
I really enjoyed the artwork in this. I thought it was very fun, very bright, very vibrant, very vivid. Aside from the obvious reasons, I actually enjoyed just how kind of pretty and colorful this whole thing looked. I mean, I don't know if you guys got the same sense, but I really feel like Paul Dini and Mark Andreyko and everybody who worked on this comic had just so much fun putting it all together. You know, this feels like a labor of love, which I really enjoyed about it. Like, you know, this doesn't come across like a chore or a corporate product. This comes across like they sat around, got high. It was like, wouldn't it be funny if Poison Ivy and Harley had like a gal pal book with Betty and Veronica? And they stopped smoking pot for just a second to write down some notes. Then they took a nap. Then they woke up and ate some Cheerios. Then they worked on this comic.
Yeah.
With Paul Dini saying, gotta work in Zatanna.
Yeah, that's as soon as I saw Zatanna, I was like, who's writing this book? And then I was like, oh, yeah, that's right. And no wonder.
Yes.
It all makes sense now.
Yep.
Like all of a sudden, all the pieces fit.
Mm-hmm. Issues 3 and 4. So in issue 3, the pair begin to realize their bodies have been switched, and they start to live each other's lives for a little while. Veronica has a fun time trying to get used to Ivy's powers because, you know, they changed bodies. So now Veronica has these powers over plants that she's learning. And I thought it was hilarious. I know, you know, this book is specifically made for humor. And it's funny that I picked this book to point this out. The fact that, you know, Betty and Veronica, who are now in Harley and Ivy's bodies, decide to go traipsing around Gotham dressed as the villains themselves to go and buy a car.
Probably the dumbest. I don't really get that. It's like, so they know that they're criminals. They come to this grass and they just decide to take a big thing of cash and Harley's mallet and just walk down. They're like, oh, look, cops, that helps us. It's like, okay, I know that Veronica Lodge is not this brightest bulb of all time.
But Betty should know better.
Yeah.
Betty should know.
In defense of teenage girls doing stupid things, they've never been in this situation before. They were just kind of thrown into it. They're not even in their own bodies. They're probably not thinking tremendously straight. I say we cut them some slack. Come on. Let's hear these girls out and give them a fair chance here. They're just trying to get through a horrible situation.
I guarantee you that they have at least some normal clothes in the closet at the place that they live.
Who's thinking about, look, Jesse, if all of a sudden you and I exchange clothing, exchange bodies, we just woke up in each other's bodies.
Let's exchange clothing.
Is the first thing you're going to be thinking about, like, oh, I got to change these camouflage sweatpants.
This doesn't fit right. What am I doing here? I don't know. If I look myself in the mirror and I see you, who happens to be a Gotham criminal, I'm going to try and like.
You but know, are you a teenage girl? That's
no.
The other
okay.
Thing.
Well, there's good question. No,
listen,
I am not.
I live with a 9-year-old girl who I'm pretty sure couldn't find her ass from her elbow if she switched into another person's body. She can't find her ass from her elbow on a normal school morning when she's getting ready for school. Come on, Jesse. You know what I'm talking about.
I hear you, sir.
Quick question. Can you guys tell me what's up with the scene with the weird looking money?
Okay, so this is where they go into the car lot and they talk to the guy and they hand him the sack of money, which does not look like money to me. It looks like a bunch of funny.
Yeah, I didn't know what that was.
He apparently either knows or works for Lenny the Lamprey, who's this guy that Hiram got involved with. But I mean, yeah, the money, I mean, it even says it on the freaking, he's holding the money in his hand, which looks completely oversized. And I swear on the front of it, it says FUNN. So it has to be something it says funny money, $1, one Harley buck.
Okay, I can understand Veronica not knowing that that's what real money looks like, because she's probably never seen anything either lower than $100 bill or on a credit card. But how does Betty look at that bag and not go, oh crap, that's not real money?
I don't know. There's so many things that I want to pick on this book for, stuff like that. But then I have to say to myself, it's an Archie comic. Okay. don't even waste your time trying to pick this apart. Yeah. Don't overthink it. That's the only thing I can think of. But you're right. I mean, they bring a bag full of cash to a freaking car lot and it's all fake money. And he just looks at it. And I mean, Betty said, I think it's Betty. I can't tell which one's on the left. I think it's Betty. And she says, what's wrong? Not enough.
See, I thought that was Veronica because it looks like she's got a leaf at the end of the hair in the silhouette.
Oh, yeah, you're right. It might be.
Which
either
makes
way.
Less sense then.
Yeah. And I on the right hand side, it's got I can see the elbow pad there. Yeah. But yeah. So, yeah, this guy's obviously, as soon as he sees D2 walk in, he gives him a car and then he immediately calls Lenny the Lamprey, who, you know, I didn't mention this in my synopsis because it would have just, there's a whole side plot that starts out with this Lenny the Lamprey guy who's going after Harley and Ivy. And just so happens he's also in business with Hiram. So when this purchase goes down, the car dealer calls the Lenny the Lamprey and he's like, yeah, they're right here. You might want to come get them. So that starts a whole big thing of trying to send some dudes after Harley and Ivy, which are Betty and Veronica. Oh my goodness, they're in way over their heads. So back at Riverdale, Harley is in Betty's body and she aces a gym test. Meanwhile, Ivy in Veronica's body, and I remember just like Alexis said, Veronica's not so bright, but there's this pop quiz or a test that's given. And Ivy's kind of worried at first, but then she realizes she's actually in botany class. So she's easily able to ace the test. In issue 3, Archie and Jughead. Yeah, we didn't talk about them much here, but they start to realize that there's something kind of crazy going on here because Veronica and Betty seem to be hanging out a lot more than they usually do. Meanwhile, Giggles McGee and the Peachhead Henry. Something happens where Reggie, who got concussed, he got concussed at the gala, wakes up, sees that he's dressed as the Joker and believes he's the Joker from there on out. I think he saves like Betty and Veronica by hitting Peachhead Henry over the head with a huge hammer. and exposing the pit, if I might say. If I remember correctly, I mean, the pit of... I thought the dude was dead. I mean, I was like, this guy's dead. So, issue four, Betty and Veronica, again, switched in the bodies of Harley and Ivy, have to try to escape with Reggie slash Joker from the police. They're finally able to get Reggie to come back to his senses with a kiss, nonetheless. The Blossoms. Oh, yes. Cheryl and Jason Blossom. These troublemakers, and they are always up to no good in Riverdale. They enact a plan for revenge because apparently they weren't invited to the costume gala. There's a plan where they're going to scare Archie, and they've taken, I think, Betty and Veronica out on dates. So anyway, long story short, there's a plan to where they're going to scare them at this drive-in theater. But Ivy and Harley agree to go on the dates because, well, turns out the drive-in is right by Sweetwater Swamp. And they are going to try to come up with a plan to sabotage Hiram from draining the swamp. All right. Betty and Veronica in Gotham get arrested for trying to buy clothes after a friend of Veronica's recognizes... That was funny. Recognizes the pair as villains. And who was it? Ivy was trying to use Veronica's credit card numbers.
Yeah, I love it. It's like you took four semesters and a summer school to get through algebra. How do you have your store account numbers memorized?
You always remember the important shit.
So at this point, when she they decide to run from the cops, Betty embraces her inner Harley, which was hilarious. She goes, they don't go and steal a car. They steal a taco truck. And they're driving around the streets of Gotham trying to escape the police. And by the end of issue four, Poison Ivy and Harley Quinn, I think, wake up, or it's the end of the day. I can't remember. But it was after the whole Blossom debacle. Poison Ivy ends up getting Poison Ivy.
Yeah, she grabs a bunch of Poison Ivy leaves and puts them all over Cheryl Blossom's face.
Yes.
I actually am allergic to Poison Ivy, and I've had more than my fair share of encounters with it in my life, and that just made me just go, oh, hell no. Oh, my God.
Have you ever had it on your face?
Thankfully, no. I have had it mostly arms, legs, I think once on my stomach.
So speaking of stupid teenage stories, I once, it was a lot of fun back in the day, like when I was 14 or 15 years old. We would go out like on a Friday or a Saturday night. And listen, it's Appalachia. We don't have much to do around here, especially out in the country. So what you did was you went out and you basically, if a car was coming, you went out at midnight or something like that, pitch black. If a car was coming, you dove into the weeds so the car wouldn't see you. I dove smack dab face first into some type of either poison ivy or poison oak. And I got it all over my lips and my... I can't even tell you, like, the trauma. I stayed home. I had to stay home from school because my lips swolled up, like the top of my lips swolled.
Jesse, yes, sir. Did they swell up like this?
They swelled up. Yes, they did. Yes, they did. It was bad. It was really bad. So I've had it on my face, and when I mow the yard around here, every once in a while, I'll get it on my arms. And recently, it was just stupid, idiotic me. I was trying to test out the weed eater we had here. I hadn't run it for a while. So I was testing it out, had sandals on it, and I went out and I was like, well, I'm just going to go real quick up around the ditch. I didn't see any poison ivy, but apparently there was some there because I had poison ivy every spot where my feet were exposed by my sandals.
Oh my God.
And that lasted for a week. And here's what you got to remember. Okay, when you get poison ivy on your arms, that's exposed to air. Okay, that has time to dry out as quick. Now imagine having to put in socks and shoes all day and go to work.
Didn't Dante describe that in one of the circles of hell?
It was for a week and a half for me. It was bad. It was bad. All right. Enough about me. Issues three and four. Alexis, we'll start with you. What do you have to say about those two issues?
Like I said, I love the idea of Poison Ivy actually using Poison Ivy on someone. But yeah, that's freaking hilarious. And she's like, oh, yeah, that's right. I don't have my, natural defense against toxins anymore. I would like to add that these artists need to do a better job of representing what Poison Ivy on the body looks like. It looks like they just got her face dirty and everything. And Jesse, I'm sure you'll agree with me here going,
no.
Red and splotchy and swollen.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it definitely does not look like, you know, somebody took a pencil and just wrote on your arm.
It's just a little bit of scribble scrabble.
No, it does not look like that. Blisters. Mark, what do you think of 3 and 4 here?
I enjoyed the further antics of Betty and Veronica. The Harley Ivy stuff is always good, but they are fairly competent adult women crooks who are, you know, so and kind of seeing them navigate high school. Like, I love the bit where Ivy's like, how do I do high school? I went from like, what was it? I went from like elementary school to college or something like that.
Oh, yeah. She graduated
something. Yeah.
Yeah. It was sixth grade, I think, was her last thing that she did. Yeah.
And that's the other side of it is when we see Ivy in the usual Batman comic book, she's more eco-terrorist, villainous. You know, you don't always get the best sense that she's a genius. And yeah. I like the fact they played on that here. The one of the big great things about this comic, for, you know, someone who just sort of glances at it might think it, you know, it's a little exploitive, you know, it's a little, oh, this is for 13-year-old boys, isn't it, kind of a thing. But when you think about these characters and how they're being portrayed, these writers took great pains to play on their strengths, not their deficiencies. And certainly, as, you know, I mentioned before, and now I will say it because I think it plays into the purposefulness of how they did this comic. Yeah, they drew them as buxom and sexy ladies, but they didn't exploit their sexuality in any way. These were real characters with strengths and some foibles, and they played more on their strengths than they did their foibles, and that's what made this, some for me, an enjoyable read. So when you see Ivy and Harley, you know, as Betty and Veronica, and they're trying to, and there's a big sitcom feel to that, you know, it's a Freaky Friday thing going on, the whole thing is a Freaky Friday thing. They had some great fun with that. And I did like the fact that Archie isn't a complete boob. Yeah. He actually picks up on the fact that something stinks in Denmark, mm-hmm. that this isn't right. They're not how they normally are. So he's somewhat perceptive. And I like the fact that Jughead, who, I don't know if you know this, but his last name is actually Rattledge, right out of the old family tree there. Just no matter what's happening, he's worried about cheeseburgers.
Yep, burger in hand.
I love that. You know, the town's on fire. They're having problems everywhere. And what's Jughead doing? How do I get a cheeseburger out of this situation? That's really right. The important thing.
That is right. He's got to eat.
Somebody once mentioned that one of the hallmarks of a man-child is the inability to focus on the important things. And I said, I think that's all about perception.
You know his last name is Jones, right?
It's Rattledge.
No, it's Jones.
it's Jughead Rattledge.
Okay, well, okay. Do you know what his first name actually is?
Mark.
That's is it Forsyth?
Yeah, Forsyth. Forsyth Pendleton Jones III.
Yeah. Forsyth.
That's all Croatian for Mark Rattledge.
Oh, okay. There we go. Now we've got it figured out. This is a fun story. It's a fun story all the way around. The innocence of Archie Comics does shine through here.
Yeah, they're having fun with the motifs.
I do have to ask, and maybe it's been a while since I've been in high school and was subjected to bratty girls, but how does getting sprayed with maple syrup and then having that photo sent to everyone in the school count as nightmarish revenge?
Well, I mean, the intent is to embarrass the person. Oh, you know, somebody had maple syrup pouring on them. Ha ha, pancake girl. It's, you know, I mean, how, you know, you can't go too far because it is an Archie comic. This is for fun.
And the maple syrup, obviously, that's the Blossom signature, too.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah.
That's having fortune.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, it's just, it's a cause to ridicule because she's embarrassed. That's all.
And it makes for, yeah, some, I'd hate to get, I would, if there's one thing I would hate to get covered with, that's maple syrup.
I think I would any number of salad dressings would be worse because gross.
Hey, I've been covered with whipped cream and had it dry and start to smell sour on me all day in school.
Ew, man, I
had to do an informational speech, so I did it on comedy. And I talked about the history of, like, comedy and theater.
And did somebody hit you with a banana cream pie?
Throwing tomatoes and whipped cream.
Well, actually, I covered my audience in Silly String, played clips from Monty Python, told stand-up, and then I hit myself in the face with a whipped cream pie.
The problem is
that was the first class of the day, and I was able to wash most of it off in the bathroom, but that shit sticks in your hair.
Yep.
So I spent the rest of the day with my hair looking like I had applied a whole bottle of hair gel on my head and smelling of sour milk.
Jesse, when did you quit watching Monday Night Raw?
It's been years now, Mark. Years, sir.
Well, no, I'm wondering if you watched during one of the initial diva searches, because there was a specific incident that I'm referencing regarding banana cream pies in the face.
I don't know
if you remember this or not, but during one of the initial diva searches, they were messing with all the girls to see how they'd react. And so they said, cut a promo into this camera. And like, they gave him no other material. There's like, just cut a promo. So the girl starts talking, and then a hand comes from out of frame and smacks the girl dead in the face with a banana cream pie.
Nice.
And the object, was to see how they'd react, and they were judged on their reaction. So some of the girls were like, "Ah, I'm blind," you know, which I enjoyed.
Yeah,
some
sure.
Some of the girls like no sold it completely. They just kept doing their promo because that's so good. It's just like, and I'll tell you one thing, Hulk Hogan, pie in face.
I'm obviously being tested here. I'm obviously being tested.
Yeah, there's like,
I thought you were going to the Bugs Bunny route. I was thinking about that one cartoon with the Humphrey Bogart and the coconut custard pie with whipped cream.
My friend Dave and I, shout out to you, guy. Just that's an ongoing bit between us. We'll say something about somebody and they'll be like, your pie, sir. Pick a pie.
Why did you hit me in the face with a coconut custard pie with whipped cream?
Now listen, Chubby. You got about one more minute to get fried rabbit. And, I'm sorry, Mr. Bogart. I couldn't do it. Maybe we'll just have to have a ham sandwich. Boy, have I been saying that one for years.
you guys know your cartoons, damn.
I'm trying to figure out what the hell you were doing with your Elmer Fudd. That sounded more like Scarlett O'Hara.
Listen, lady, I'm lucky I can breathe right now. I have to forgive me if my impressions are not spot on. Last night, my impression of Vince McMahon was basically me just yelling in a guttural voice. Take her!
That is Vince McMahon.
It's a little more throaty. Anyway, the point is, pies in the face are funny.
Mm, true.
Classic comedy.
Well, we've got there. All right, now let's go somewhere else. So, issues 5 and 6. So, Betty and Veronica track down Sabrina Spellman to find out they just need to make physical contact with Harley and Ivy to switch back. We also see where Sabrina apparently can just automatically blip memories. So, she blips Betty and Veronica's memories, so they have no idea that Sabrina did what she did. Plus, she has a talking cat named Salem. She does not know. They do not know that.
I was saying, did she transport them as well? That was really not well established.
I do not know. There's been 3 or 4 times throughout this book where I was trying to figure out how people got from location to location. That was one of them. There's another one when the bombs start to go off. No, it's right after Poison Ivy escapes from the wherever they're at in the Sweetwater Swamp. I don't know if she used the green and transported them out of the swamp. I have no idea. But I know there's been a couple times where I'm just like, how the hell did they get here? I have no clue. I mean, at one point, we get an explanation as to why Harley and Ivy are in this Riverdale and also turning themselves into the police. And that's because there's apparently you could just make plant duplicates of yourself. So we'll get to that. But anyway, here we go. Betty, Veronica, Harley, and Ivy go to confront Hiram, and Ivy uses her powers to get him to give her the deed, double-crossing their new friends. She goes in there, and she uses her powers to make Hiram give her the deed to Sweetwater Swamp. We get a confrontation between the two pairs, because obviously Betty and Veronica don't like this new turn of events. Now, Alexis, real quick. I'm pausing here because I want you to do me a favor, and I want you to, if you can find the page where they're fighting, we got Betty and Veronica versus Harley and Ivy in issue 5. Probably don't have it in front of you, do you?
Actually, I do.
Okay.
Is this the one where Veronica gets the sword off the wall?
Yeah. Do you recognize that sword?
Dun, 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 dun!
Yeah, somebody pointed out that is apparently very close to the Master Sword from Legend of Zelda.
A right shape.
Yes. Yeah. I was going to say the Master Sword's blue, isn't it? Like,
The hilt is blue. This one's is gold.
That's right. So anyway, they're fighting back and forth there at the Lodge Estate, I believe. Meanwhile, Lenny the Lamprey send Peachhead Henry and Giggles to Hiram's, and they just happen to walk in on as the girls are fighting each other. The whole point is for them, they're going to make sure that this project fails. They take Hiram and all four prisoner and take them to the swamp, setting up a plan to blow the swamp up. And this explosion is going to kill Hiram, Betty, Veronica, Poison Ivy, and Harley in the process. Now, during the fracas, okay, Veronica's butler, Smithers, takes a punch to the face and then wakes up afterwards and realizes what has gone on. And he makes a call to one of his earlier MI5 associates. That's right. Smithers knows Alfred Pennyworth.
Well, really, why wouldn't he? All butlers know each other.
It really is a small world after all.
Yes, indeed. All right, issue 6. Ivy is able to escape from being tied up and put in a hanging culvert. She's able to escape minutes before the explosion, rescuing everyone, and all four are able to dispose of the bombs before any harm comes to the swamp and the bystanders of Riverdale who have come there to watch this. I don't know if it was a christening ceremony or whatever that was going to happen with the swamp. Alfred shows up with Smithers in tow, and they're able to help Reggie and Hiram escape. Reggie's still dressed up like the Joker. I don't know how many days have passed, at least 3, and he's still wearing the same clothes and makeup.
Yeah, how is that makeup not rubbed off?
No idea. Lenny the Lamprey, who showed up shortly after his Peachhead Henry and Giggles, he shows up and he's captured. And the way that he's captured is interesting. He tries to run down Harley, but Poison Ivy ends up growing this big, large rose bush around his car. And I don't know if it was me or if the way it was drawn, or maybe it's just the way I took it, but it looks like Lenny the Lamprey does not like the smell of roses. All right. She puts these roses around it, and it looks like he's covering his nose. Betty and Veronica tell Harley and Poison Ivy they're not going to call the cops on him. Hey, it's okay. But they still have to deal with Giggles and Peachhead. Now, Jughead, this is where Jughead and Archie actually show up and do something. Jughead's able to take out Giggles with... This is straight up goofy Archie comics. He's able to take out Giggles with the potent super stinko chopped onion burger. And it turns Giggles laughs into cries and sobs. All right. And then that allows
Ivy uses her powers to turn Peachhead into a tree.
Oh, jeez. Gravity, this guy, man, poor Peachhead Henry. I mean, obviously he got into a life of crime, but you just don't, you're not going to last that long with a soft fruit for a face. It's just not going to happen.
And he's still conscious as a tree. We have a scene where Ivy plucks a peach off of his branch and he goes, ow.
That is horrifying.
Yeah.
And we all learn.
It's like all of a sudden we got the scene from freaking Wizard of Oz with the owl.
Damn it.
As we all learn, Mark Radlich, tell us.
As we all learned from the Wizard of Oz part, you know, Alexis Haina just reminded us, when you pull an apple off a tree, it hurts, goddammit. Listen, would you like it if someone walked along and plucked something off of you?
This is not a level of body horror that I like to see in an Archie comic. Not at all. Not at all. Well, Hiram renounces his plan for the swamp and says he will donate it to the Riverdale Preservation Society, all the while taking a bath, apparently, on the millions that he's invested in on this free college / superstore retail center that he had and planned. Yeah, as mentioned before, plant duplicates take the heat for some of the mischief, and that absolves Betty and Veronica of any wrongdoing. So, yeah, plant duplicates of Harley and Ivy show up at the cop station and turn themselves in. I don't know. It's Archie Comics. Harley and Jughead have a burger eating contest. I mean, that's just how you have to finish this whole 6-issue series out. there has to be a some type of an eating contest that Jughead is involved in. And then I think Jughead wins by forfeit. I'm team Jughead here when it comes to that. And then Harley and Poison Ivy leave after a police car crashes into Pop's chocolate shop. It crashes into the shop, driven by apparently the plant duplicates. And they get in the cop car and they take off, head back to Gotham. And that is our silly, wacky, zany story involving Betty and Veronica and Harley Quinn and Poison Ivy.
With sneaking away in the back seat and them leaving him tied up on the sign to Gotham.
I know DC Comics tends to treat Harley Quinn like a sex kitten. You know, they tend to put her in these situations where she's like a sociopath. You know, and she's exploitive and all of this other stuff.
Some do. I mean, it's
some. But that's what I was getting to. I think there's two ways to write Harley. There's this way, and another really great example of how I like to read Harley, the kinds of stories that appeal to me. Her limited series she did with Power Girl is hilarious. I don't know if you've read this. We've never covered it on source material, but there was a period where I actually was reading stuff that wasn't on this show. Mm. And I was reading through the Harley Quinn New 52 series, and there's a section where she goes into space with Power Girl for like 4 or 5, 6 issues. And it's a part of that narrative, but they did like a side story with the two of them. And it's hilarious. It turns gender stereotypes on their head. Harley Quinn is so funny, like, because they write her with this need for approval, which tracks, you know, given her relationship with the Joker. But counter to that is her being completely done with the Joker. Like, she still wants that acceptance. She wants that validation. But she's willing to look to get it from Power Girl or Poison Ivy or somebody else who's a little bit more healthy for her. And, you know, she's kind of like instead of being like chaotic evil, she becomes chaotic neutral, and she's fun that way. And so all these like different partnerships that she has, whether it's Poison Ivy or Power Girl or somebody else, where it's kind of, here's a situation, we're going to throw Harley Quinn into it, and she has so much charisma, and she's so fun that it makes the whole, that, you know, her bringing in this like this chaos is a fun read, as opposed to when they go the other side of it, where she's not a lot of fun anymore, and like you almost feel sorry for this fictional character. This is more my speed. I loved. I this was zany. This was very. This was smartly written for what it was. This was colorful and bright. This was absolutely perfect.
We have to look at the writing team, and you know, half of that writing team, Paul Dini. All right, we read the Zatanna series. Zatanna's known for, you know, obviously how attractive she looks and how she's been used in other stories. That didn't come across. Paul Dini did not write her as hypersexual in any way in that series. Mind you, he was part creator with Bruce Timm for Harley Quinn. You know, this is his creation, and it seems like he knows how to write a story involving Harley Quinn that, just like you're saying, Mark, it doesn't have that darker, more sexual side to it, which is, this is the kind of story I prefer Harley Quinn being in as well. It's funny. It's almost, you know, it's kind of wholesome, you'd say. I think a lot of that has to be credited to, obviously, who's taking the character and writing about it. He treats it with a lot of respect.
I definitely agree with you guys. In a less abled writer's hand, I mean, the scene where Ivy as Veronica is in the class and she's about to take a test probably would have had it with her trying. We know that Poison Ivy, you know, usually secretes pheromones and likes to seduce men to doing her bidding. We would have probably had a scene where Veronica had temporarily forgotten that she didn't have her powers and was trying to seduce the teacher or something before she realized, oh crap, that's right, I don't have my pheromones anymore. But we didn't have that. I have to admit, the only thing I really didn't like about these last two episodes was the style of art, or the artwork for the scene where they're getting rid of the bombs. It's very hard to follow what the heck they're doing.
Were there bombs that were actual circles in this? Because a lot of it looked like dynamite, and then all of a sudden you see Harley like throwing, like, I mean, cartoon bombs out of the panel. And I'm like, okay, these were buried somewhere.
I actually very much agree with Alexis. If I had one one negative thing that I had to say with the gun to my head. It's the artwork is very busy, and unless you're really being, you know, I had to reread some things a few times and look at it very closely in order to make certain things out.
I don't know if I would keep this to six issues. I really don't, because I don't know. I was looking at trying to figure out the formula. Clearly, the important beats are you got to get the two pair together. You got to get them to switch bodies. And then, of course, you got to have them do a day in the life of for each one of them. And then the big plot. Like, the last two issues probably could have been concentrated into one. I don't know. For six issues, it is what it is. There were many times where I had to remind myself, this is DC and Archie Comics. Okay. You can't take too much too seriously. You can't criticize too much because it's supposed to be something that doesn't make a whole lot of sense sometimes. Trust me, watch the Riverdale show and you will start to learn that even a live action show based on Riverdale characters is still going to take the nonsensical and put it out there on display. Alexis, anything else? Any final thoughts?
Like I said before, we need Zatanna and Sabrina teaming up in the next issue. For the love of all that is good, holy, and covered in chocolate, someone make that happen.
Mark Radulich, any other thoughts on top of what you've already said?
I want an animated movie now.
Oh, really?
Yeah, give me the animated movie of Harley and Ivy. I want two things. I want an animated movie of Harley, and I want a pony. And I want an animated movie of Harley and Ivy meet Betty and Veronica. And somewhere at an independent show, I don't care where, I want Harley and Ivy versus Betty and Veronica.
Oh, my. Versus.
I don't care if it's for guys dressed in drag. I don't care if it's for girls. I need two people dressed up as Harley and Ivy. I need two people dressed up as Betty and Veronica. And I need them to wrestle.
You know what? From what I understand, Ronnie was talking about it. And Alexis, you might have mentioned it, too. I don't remember. But there was apparently some wrestling promotion that was going around with cons doing, cosplay wrestling.
So, yeah, it's a pretty common thing to see at some of the smaller shows.
Yeah. So you never know, Mark. That might have already happened. They may already be women tag team champions of the world.
Well, there's 900 shows coming to Tampa, assuming everything doesn't get canceled because of the coronavirus. But I'm sure if all the shows stay intact, it'll be one of those 900 shows in Tampa WrestleMania weekend.
Well, with that being said, we have reached the conclusion of our discussion of Harley and Ivy meet Betty and Veronica. I guess we'll go ahead and get into plugs. So, Alexis Haina, what do you have going on with Honeysuckle Rose Creations recently?
Really excited because Planet Comic-Con is right around the corner, and I am so thrilled we're finally going to be back to working at shows. So done with this downtime. We have been off from the convention scene the entire winter. Spring has come early. Thank you, O Sacred Groundhog. And I am really excited to be working this show here in Kansas City. We also have a bunch of brand new merchandise in both our Etsy store and our Handmade at Amazon store. There we go. I need more caffeine. And of course, you can always find us on Facebook, Instagram, and under Duress Twitter.
All right. Very good. Mark Radulich, the schedule, sir.
All right. Tomorrow, Alexis Haina will be joining myself and Robert Winfrey discussing the newest Pixar animated feature, sure to earn $1 billion, because they all do, except for The Good Dinosaur. But we don't talk about that or The Shortcut. That movie is Onward. Onward, Alexis Haina. Are you ready to join us on a fantastic quest?
I just love that since Robert's not here, you had to work in the Simpsons reference.
it's a common thing on the network. Yes, we will be reviewing Onward tomorrow night on Damn You Hollywood. Wednesday, Jesse.
Body count in the house.
Body counts in the house.
Body count.
Body counts in the house.
Body count.
Oh, and the motherfucking place to be. On the Metal Hammer of Doom, myself and Jesse Starkshire will be paying tribute to the gods of metal, body count. And I don't know if you understood what we were trying to tell you, Alexis Haina, but body count's in the house.
Body count. Alexis is done with your shenanigans. Move on, sir.
Alexis is not in the house. Okay.
No, Alexis is looking at the cover variants in the back of the book and looking.
I wanted to ask you if you had a favorite cover.
Yeah, hang on a second. Let me see. Actually, I think the one that I genuinely like is by Jay Lee and June Chung. There's something just very neat and clean about it. And I just find Harley trying to flap the bat wings like a Wile E. Coyote cartoon so freaking hilarious.
Jay Lee's a great artist. I really like the cover of issue 4. I assume this is the regular cover where it's got like a bullseye and each concentric. Is it concentric? Is that the word? Circle?
Concentric.
Concentric. Silence is concentric. Each circle is like it has an outline of Harley. Yeah, Harley. It's Harley and Ivy, and then the next one is Betty and Veronica. And they're dressed in their cheerleader uniforms. I think that looks awesome. That's one of my favorites.
I have seen Harley and Ivy cheerleader cosplays, and probably going to see a lot more.
I was going to say, yeah, there's probably going to be quite few.
Actually, that's quite common, especially since we had the Batgirl actually dressed like a female bat baseball player cosplay that's been so popular. So you get a lot of people doing Harley and Ivy variants of that and all going together as a group.
So on Wednesday, March 11th, the same day as the Body Count review, earlier in the day, myself and the Podsman will be reviewing WWE Elimination Chamber. The last stop, Jesse Starcher, on the way to WrestleMania.
That's right.
On April 5th, unless it gets canceled because of the coronavirus. And then...
Is that going to be to be determined? Card subject to change due to coronavirus. Yeah.
And then on Thursday, March 12th, we'll be doing a TV party. Myself and David Wright will be doing a TV party for the animated Harley Quinn show, which don't waste your time with that piece of trash that was the Birds of Prey movie. Get yourself a DC Universe account and watch the Harley Quinn show. It is hysterical. Whatever your thoughts of Kaley Cuoco from Big Bang Theory, she is amazing in this. The Hulk voice cast is freaking amazing. This is one of the best written for the stage and screen adaptations of Harley Quinn and performances of Harley Quinn I've seen in quite some time. Not since Birds of Prey in 2002. Have I seen someone portray Harley Quinn so well and so entertainingly, right, Alexis Aina?
Be sure to check out our previous recordings of Damn You Hollywood's review of Birds of Prey, the Harley Quinn story, along with Birds of the TV Party Tonight look at the 2002 Birds of Prey series, a.k.a. when bitchy high school girls think they know how to act.
Yes, it was a phenomenal performance. How they didn't win an Emmy, I'll never know. Emmy. I'm doing it for me, Jesse. M.E.
Shut up, Griffin.
And speaking of Peter Griffin, myself and John War will be doing some boxing coverage this Saturday. Oh, Jesse, if you watch one boxing event, you should watch this one. The last time Shakur Stevenson fought, and they asked him, what do you think of your opponent? He said, he a bitch.
Oh, he a bitch.
A bitch.
Oh, my goodness. Now he's fighting Miguel Mariaga. Say that
Mariaga.
One for me. Mariaga. Mariachi. Mariaga.
Yes, sir. Yes, Miguel Mariachi.
This is quickly becoming Mike Tyson's punch out.
Man, even with the podcast dad here, we keep getting off on sidetracks.
So, yes, Shakur Stevenson, Shakur he a bitch Stevenson versus Miguel Mariachi, myself and...
Oh, boy, that's going to stick.
Yup. We'll be doing alternative commentary for that. What's in the box? We've got our source material for October Faction Volume 1. Jesse and I had a good time on that. Jesse and I reviewed October Faction, the first season on Netflix. We reviewed the new Five Finger Death Punch. Is it Fate? Is that the name of it?
I'm going with Fate. I mean, F8. Okay. I don't know why you'd call it that.
Because you're into keyboards?
I don't even know what the F8 button does. I could tell you a couple other button combinations, but F8 is not one of them.
And then myself, Robert Winfrey, Alexis Haina, maybe Jason was there, maybe he wasn't. You'll have to go and listen to it. We reviewed The Invisible Man.
He could be the Invisible Man.
He could. Jason might have been the Invisible Man on that show. You'll never know. Unless you listen in the archives right now.
Well, if that's the case, then couldn't we all be the Invisible Man?
No, only Jason. He's the Invisible Man and the Prodigal Son.
No, he is not the Prodigal Son, sir.
And then myself and Pat Mullen did our next chapter in boxing history, Cassius Clay, who will someday be known as Muhammad Ali, but it's not this day. And then finally, myself and Robert Winfrey did alternative commentary for the latest UFC pay-per-view, UFC 248. Adesanya versus Soldier of God, Yoel Romero. I think I pulled something yelling Soldier of God. Oh, take over, Jesse.
That does not surprise me. All right, ladies and gentlemen. All right, guys, so
you know you're fat when you pull something yelling and singing.
Yeah, my gosh. Well, I don't have much else to add other than the canned plugs here that are going to play in a few. You can check out our discussion, which should be loading up either this Wednesday or last Wednesday. And I don't want to get into a whole lot about this, Mark Radulich, but yes, Superman War of the Worlds. That's right. An Elseworlds tale. Containing,
I know this. This is the one where
shut your mouth. Wells
lies to everybody about aliens. And the story is how Superman punches him in the face for it.
Superman has some problems there in the 30s with some aliens that drop down to the Earth, and the tripods are taking over and obliterate the world as we know it. And lo and behold, one standing figure alone is able to try and stop it, and that is Superman. So that'll be popping up either, like I said, on Unspoken Issues either this past Wednesday or this coming Wednesday, whenever we get the editing done. So other than that, for Alexis Haina of Honeysuckle Rose Creations, for Mark Radulich, I am Jesse Starcher. Have a good evening, a good night.
Thank you very much for joining us. Do not forget to subscribe to our new home by punching in W2M Network on just about any podcast platform to get all of our content into your audio feed. Also, give a like to the Radulich in Broadcasting Network and W2Mnet.com Facebook page in order to stay on top of everything that we have to offer. If you'd like to follow the Source Material Podcast on social media, just follow @SourceMatCast on Twitter, and we are on Facebook @SourceMaterialComicsPodcast. If you enjoyed what you heard, please feel free to share. We look forward to entertaining you again soon.
Of Harley and Ivy. They look a lot more like you would see in DC Comics. Awesome
is what your word you're looking for.
They're definitely drawn in an adult style. So, not Jesse, porn adults.
Jesse, you please wipe your brow. You're sweating a lot.
Yeah, I'm not uncomfortable at all. You're uncomfortable, Mark.
Peachhead, henchman Mick, shoot him up. It's the Joker, the Joker, the Joker, the Joker, the Riddler, and the Joker.
The Midnight Smoker, or the Midnight Token.
Both.
Oh.
Why are you racist against fun?
I know. Listen.
Yes, sir.
Peachhead's fine.
Come here, Wikipedia.
Come here, little Wikipedia.
Does your youngest still put his clothing on either inside out or backwards? Because no, mine does. And it's like, no, please stop leaving the house looking like a clown. And then there's my son who will put everything on either inside out or backwards or whatever. And then when you tell him, dress yourself appropriately, you're in kindergarten for fuck's sake. And he gets mad at you because why does he have to get dressed twice?
Okay, so moving on.
I got blisters on my fingers.
I got blisters on my lips. I got lipsters. Wait a second.
But is your kiss on my lips? That's the question.
That's your kiss.
It's
your kiss.
On my lips. Better turn out the lights.
See, I've actually got the Animaniacs Poison Oak song stuck in my head.
I have no idea how that goes.
Oh dear, I seem to have the itchies all of a sudden.
Look, Scratchy's itching.
That bush you went in must have been poison oak.
Poison oak?
Oh, do let's sing about it.
About my poison oak?
Yes, let's.
I think she's crazy.
Duh. Poison oak. Makes you itch if you catch it.
Is there a point to this cartoon?
I don't know, but we're still getting paid.
Blushing.
skin turns red, blisters spread. Spread the more that you scratch it. Chafing and stinging, the itch gets worse. Itch gets worse, it's burning. Sing! Poison O, for days to come you'll be hurting. Oh my, wasn't that fun?
I'm scared.
Unless anybody has anything else to say about 3 and 4, we're moving on. We'll close this out. Silence is consent. All right.
Oh, hey.
Unless you count Eddie there trying to object.
Eddie, what do you have to say, sir, about issues 3 and 4? All right, then. Squeak, squeak.
Anyone else alarmed by the fact that Alexis and I were on the same wavelength trying to make the same joke?
Actually, I'm not. You guys, like, I swear to goodness, were raised in the Warner Brothers water tower. That's...
I'm gonna go with Yakko.
You're going with Yakko.
Yes.
Okay, then you have to do the countries or the nations of the world song.
Believe me, I'm working on it.
And now the nations of the world, brought to you by Yakko Warner.
United States, Canada, Mexico, Panama, Haiti, Jamaica, Peru, Republic, Dominican, Cuba, Caribbean, Greenland, El Salvador, too, Puerto Rico, Colombia, Venezuela, Honduras, Guyana, and still, Guatemala, Bolivia, then Argentina, and Ecuador, Chile, Brazil, Costa Rica, Belize, Nicaragua, Bermuda, Bahamas, Tobago, San Juan, Paraguay, Uruguay, Suriname, and French Guiana, Barbados, and Guam. Norway and Sweden and Iceland and Finland and Germany now one piece. Switzerland, Austria, Czechoslovakia, Italy, Turkey and Greece. Poland, Romania, Scotland, Albania, Ireland, Russia, Oman. Bulgaria, Saudi Arabia, Hungary, Cyprus, Iraq and Iran. There's Syria, Lebanon, Israel, Jordan, both Yemen, Kuwait and Bahrain. The Netherlands, Luxembourg, Belgium and Portugal, France, England, Denmark and Spain. India, Pakistan, Burma, Afghanistan, Thailand, Nepal, and Bhutan, Cambodia, Malaysia, then Bangladesh, Asia, and China, Korea, Japan, Mongolia, Laos, and Tibet, Indonesia, the Philippine Islands, Taiwan, Sri Lanka, New Guinea, Sumatra, New Zealand, then Borneo, and Vietnam, Tunisia, Morocco, Uganda, Angola, Zimbabwe, Djibouti, Botswana, Mozambique, Zambia, Swaziland, Gambia, Guinea, Algeria, Ghana. Burundi, Lesotho, and Malawi, Togo, the Spanish Sahara is gone. Niger, Nigeria, Chad, and Liberia, Egypt, Benin, and Gabon. Tanzania, Somalia, Kenya, and Mali, Sierra Leone, and Algeria. Dahomey, Namibia, Senegal, Libya, Cameroon, Congo, Zaire, Ethiopia, Guinea, Bissau, Madagascar, Rwanda, Mayor, and Cayman. Hong Kong, Abu Dhabi, Qatar, Yugoslavia, Crete, Mauritania, then Transylvania, Monaco, Liechtenstein, Malta, and Palestine, Fiji, Australia, Sudan.
I have a more important question. Do you have a favorite body count song?
Is it? Oh, man. I don't want to say the titles.
You already owe me a churro and a Dole Whip. Do not keep racking up what other Disney food you have to buy me, or so help me God, I will throw in a turkey leg.
You need to stop yourself over there, Mark Radulich. Stop yourself.
Never.
There we go. And that's that.